Welcome to Hail Varsity Radio, the voice of Husker Nation. Insight, opinion, expertise, with the biggest and best names talking Nebraska across the state. Join the show on Twitter at Hail Varsity and at Schmidt_radio. Call in at 402-466-ESPN or 1-800-825-5865. Here's Chris Schmidt.
Welcome to it. It's a Thursday. Hail Varsity Radio presented by the Nebraska Lottery. Chris Schmidt, Elijah Herbel, and you. We are inching closer and closer to Norman. And plenty to get thoughts on with some standouts that played for both programs. We'll hear from a fullback. And yes, he scored three touchdowns against Oklahoma. Joel Makovicka going to be with us here in about 5 to 7 minutes. Get his take on the Big Red. In our tune to Mr. Sooner Magic himself, the quarterback for that 76 comeback. And he is the Sooners insider, host of the Lincoln Riley Show. Dean Blevins in the 5 o'clock hour. We'll spend time with Gary Barnett, and we'll find out what's up with Husker volleyball and get a thought or several from Brandon Vogel, who is making the trip down to Norman as well. Numbers to get in this morning or this afternoon with Hail Varsity Radio, 466-3776, 466-3776, 800-825-5865. Can send your comments. We are streaming on ESPN Lincoln on Facebook Live, so the stream yard is open. You see Elijah still has not done away with the mustache. That's okay. And, you know, just let that thing grow. Are you going to let it grow till there's a road win over a ranked team?
Well, the thing is Nebraska hasn't lost a game since I have been rocking the mustache. I rocked
haven't
this
played.
Well, no. No, I shaved this the Friday before Nebraska played Fordham. They beat Fordham. They beat Buffalo. So at this point, I've determined it's a must-win mustache. That's what it is. Is whenever I have the mustache, the Huskers must win. So I'm letting it rock until I'm proven otherwise.
Look at you. Look at you, the must-win mustache. Hey, there's a lot to get into. We'll hear from Scott Frost coming up, and can send your tweets in as well at Schmidt_radio, Chris Schmidt, at Herbal Essence for Elijah Herbel. And you've got the numbers. Can email Chris at HailVarsity.com. We'll get to some more of your emails a little bit later on in the show and for sure tomorrow. Again, if you're headed down to Norman, come see us. The Cohiba Lounge is where we're at. I wish I had the address. I can pull that up in a second. But it's with Joe Washington's event that is going on 6:30 to 9:30, and it's the 50th anniversary. They're celebrating the game of the century. All the Huskers legends from yesteryear, all the Sooner greats, they're going to converge. No pigskin, no helmets, just a good time to be had by all. And we're excited to kind of lead into that 4 to 6, the Cohiba Lounge. And of course, Joe Washington's event follows that. So we're there tomorrow live with Hail Varsity Radio, weekend edition at 7 a.m., and a Real Red Reaction from the Cohiba Lounge following Nebraska and Oklahoma. Tim Bob Kitzmiller, Elijah Herbel, you're on site because you're roadieing tomorrow. I will see you around the 5 o'clock hour, I think, but first things first, plenty to get into with Nebraska. So what does Nebraska's hopes hinge on? Let's go there for a moment. Nebraska's hopes hinge on what? Is it the defense forcing some turnovers? Is it the defense making Oklahoma be hesitant, stay out of sync? Because that's really what Tulane did. Tulane got down and then they hung in. Is it about disruption for Nebraska defensively? Or, Elijah, is it really all about Adrian putting two or three Superman capes on? Because the other part of this is we don't know what Nebraska is going to have offensively to complement Adrian. We know Toure's been great, but that's about it. Everyone else is in bubble wrap right now.
Well, I hate to say it, but I think if Oklahoma comes out on their A game, playing the way you expect the top five team in the country to play, I don't think there's any way that the Huskers team can win, really. You got to hope that they haven't played two great teams, and that Nebraska can come out and, I don't want to say surprise them a little bit, but just give them a little bit of a test early and let them know early that this is going to be a game. Nebraska needs to come out and play the most complete game they've played since, I think, Michigan State in the snow in 2018. If they can come out and play a complete game like that, offensively, defensively, keeping Spencer Rattler out of rhythm, you got to force a couple turnovers, you got to keep the ball safe, then you just got to hope that Oklahoma comes out on their B game. If they're on their B game, I think they're beatable. But if Oklahoma, with the talent they have at the wide receiver position, at quarterback, along that defensive front, if they come out playing like they're going to be playing in a college football playoff game, or they're playing Texas, or they're playing in a Big 12 championship game, like, I don't think there's much Nebraska can do, honestly. But you got to come out and you got to focus on yourself. If you play the best possible game, you're giving yourself a chance.
Let's hear from a Husker Hall of Famer and a legend, get his take on Nebraska, Oklahoma. Let's spend some time with Joel Makovicka here on Hail Varsity Radio. Back into it. It's Hail Varsity Radio, presented by the Nebraska Lottery. We can't not do Oklahoma-Nebraska week and forget the major part that made the series incredible, and I'm talking fullback play. We bring in Hall of Fame fullback with Nebraska, Joel Makovicka. Joel, you got to be smiling here, man. We talk Oklahoma, Nebraska. The fullbacks were the star, weren't they?
I tell you what, you know what? Back in the day, both teams rolled with the fullback, and huge parts of the game, I think, what was it, 97?
Oh, yeah.
I think I had three touchdowns against them, and Coach Osborne's 250th win. So, you know what, this rivalry has been going on since I was a kid, and, you know, the older guys really understand it because it was one of the best rivalries in the country, and it's exciting that we get to play them again, and so we'll see how the chips fall Saturday.
Joel Makovicka with us, Makovicka Physical Therapy, of course. And Joel, a thought here. So did you pipe up during your prep week with Nebraska OU in 97 and say, hey, T.O., look, man, we got to feature the fullback this week, and two more touchdowns, you would have tied Al Bundy. I mean, three's good.
Three's good. I'll tell you what, I did that every week, not just Oklahoma week. I mean, I used to try and butter him up all week and then put it in the ear of Coach Solis to say, hey, give me the rock. So I used to do that every week. That wasn't just a rivalry week for me.
That's good. Well, it's what's, you know, what's best for the team, right, Joel?
Yeah, that's what I thought. I get the ball in the hands of your best athlete, right?
That's right, the fullback. the fullback. Yeah. What's your take on – I'll get your take on Saturday in a second, but, Joel, I'd love your thoughts here on the running back rotation and the offensive line as you see it, because the push isn't consistent, and the who's in now carrying the football, that's been inconsistent. And I feel for the players, I feel for the coaches, because they want a different result. They want a more consistent result, and if you can get a run game – helping this offense out, great things can happen.
Yeah, and I think, you know, I think ultimately the staff and the football team want to be able to run the football. I know there's we run the spread, and Coach Frost's offense is the spread, but he's talked about it since he's been here, is he wanted to always marry that with, you know, the pipeline and Nebraska power running game. And I think that's what they've wanted to do. Now, the rotation at running back, honestly, Schmidt, I've never been a huge fan of rotations at running backs, but, you know, I played in an era where, you know, you got, as a running back, you got 30 carries, 35 carries a game, and you had a workhorse. But that era has changed, you know, so I haven't ever been a big fan of, you know, running back by committee. Nebraska did it with the wee backs and those types of things, and, you know, the 80s and the 90s, a little bit when they had him, but, you know, we had a bell cow with, you know, like Lawrence Phillips and Amon Green, and got the majority of the carries. And then we had guys that were unbelievable running backs behind them that got some carries, but we had a guy. And now that's kind of changed. You see it all over the country where, you know, it's running backs by committee. And I think a lot of that is they want to keep hits off the running backs and keep them healthy. And I think that goes to back to where programs were saying, hey, we want to keep these running backs healthy and not have as much carries, because if they go on to the NFL, NFL scouts look at how many carries they've had and things like that. So, you know, all the teams around the country are doing that. Now, you know, Nebraska has to get better about moving, changing the line of scrimmage up front. There's no question about it. And as you can see, our offensive line is more physical and looking and look better. They just have to start playing to where they change the line of scrimmage, and they haven't been doing that. And it'll be interesting to see this weekend if we can, because Oklahoma, you know, has a great D line, even though they haven't showed it as much in the past couple of years, because their defense has been the weakness of their football team. But you know, we're going to have to, if we want to have a successful season, we're going to have to continue to commit to the run and be able to run the football, especially in games like this where we have to keep their offense off the field.
Is this a situation where if you're putting a game plan together, you're looking at what you have, and, you know, to kind of coin what Scott has said before, can't do it or won't do it. Is it a situation where he's like, oh, man, I don't think we can do this, or no, this is my system, and I would prefer to just kind of go my way. We can talk about downhill run game. It's another thing to doing it. I mean, I guess it's more of an emphasis question.
Well, yeah, and it's a commitment question as well. I mean, it's very difficult to continue to commit to running downhill football when you know you're getting 2 yards a carry and put yourself in second and long or third and long if you commit to the running game. And even though if you are only getting 2 or 3 yards a carry, if you continue to commit to it, the defense has to respect that. And that's a hard thing as a football staff and a play caller, is to commit to it when it's not successful. And it'll be interesting to see on how that goes on Saturday, to where I think Coach Frost has a confidence in his defense, and he knows his defense is playing pretty well right now. And if he can limit turnovers and have ball possession or time of possession advantage with our offense on the field to keep their offense off the field, I think he will commit to that, even though it might not be working the way he wants. But again, I think he's tried to emphasize this since he's been in Lincoln. It's just hard to stay committed to it when it's not working. And hopefully he continues to commit to it. And these young guys up front, you know, there's a lot of freshmen and sophomores up front, and hopefully these young guys up front continue to improve and continue to improve on changing the line of scrimmage. And as the year goes on, we run the ball better.
Few minutes here, Joel Makovicka with us, Hail Varsity Radio, Nebraska, Oklahoma week. We need the perspective of a fullback, and Joel's given that to us. Makovicka, physical therapy, of course. And Joel, when did you learn about OU Nebraska? Was it watching Saturdays after Thanksgiving, or was it the former players that kind of indoctrinated you what this means, what this is?
I think for me, it was, you know, I learned about it when I was a kid, and I was thinking about this week, and I knew you were going to have me on, and you know, I didn't know much about the series in the 70s because I wasn't born and was very young in the late 70s, and where I started really following it and seeing how much of a rivalry it was obviously the 80s and the 86 game where they tore our hearts out in Lincoln with Keith Jackson and beating us 20-17 in the Sooner Magic. And you know, it's interesting, when I grew up, I thought every year the winner of that game went to the national title or played for the national championship, and that was the game, that it was just whoever won that game was playing for the national title. Now, that wasn't correct, but that's what it felt like every year. And so I grew up with it in the 80s, and it was a little different for me when we were down in Lincoln, because at that time it was such a lopsided rivalry for us when we were down in Lincoln, because we beat them every year handily and they were down. So it wasn't the hatred and the huge rivalry for us when we were down there, because they were down and we were so good at the time. So that's one of the things I honestly felt like I missed in my career at Nebraska. We didn't have that game where it was just a flat out mark it on the calendar hatred rivalry that they had in the 80s with them, and it's just because that, you know, they were down at that time and you know, when I was at Nebraska, we beat them, you know, 37-3, 70-20, you know, things like that, 69-7. So it wasn't quite that rivalry that had in the 80s, but when I was a kid in the 80s, is there was nothing better than watching that game after Thanksgiving and knowing that whoever won that game won the Big Eight and was going on to probably play for the national title.
Yep, trip to Miami. Joel Makovicka with us, Hail Varsity Radio. Joel, a last thought, bud, and it's fun to catch up with you. Love your perspective. What happened Saturday, and what do you think can happen Saturday here with Adrian? And, you know, how's Nebraska keep this close, pull this off, and, you know, are you optimistic?
I mean, you have to be, Schmidt. You have to be optimistic. And, you know, oh, man, other than, you know, I see a couple teams in college football, and that might be two or three that, man, they look head and shoulders above the rest. Every team's beatable. And you saw that with Oklahoma in the Tulane game early in the year, where they almost got knocked off by Tulane in the first game of the year in Norman. And so there's always optimism. And I think, you know, you have a quarterback in Adrian Martinez that can change games with his legs. There's no question about it. And is a very athletic quarterback. So if you have that, you have a chance. Oklahoma is a great football team. A lot of people have picked them to win or compete for the national title and be in the playoff, and their offense and their skill and their quarterback is second to none in the country. So Nebraska's got to, you know, play well, and I don't say play a perfect game, but you know as well as I do, they can't turn the ball over, and they have to be able to establish some sort of the running game to keep Spencer Rattler and these receivers off the football field, because that's where Oklahoma hangs their hat, is outscoring a lot of people and getting ahead of people by, you know, two touchdowns to let their defensive ends and their D-line loose because they can rush the passer. So I think it's going to come down to, and you say this all the time, but especially in a game like this, if you want to upset a team that's in the top five that could go on to play for the national title, you have to not turn the ball over. And I think we have to get a few turnovers. And that's one of the things that our defense needs to do a better job of this year, is getting the ball back to our offense. They played well this year, and they'll have to do that again on Saturday for Nebraska to have a chance to win. And I'm hoping, you know, that it's a great game, and it's one of those that we can win or lose. We can cheer on this squad for fighting and playing well, and hopefully we'll see that on Saturday.
Joel Makovicka, Husker standout Hall of Famer fullback, and his thoughts on Nebraska OU. Joel, we'll see you soon, bud. Thanks for a few minutes.
Awesome. Thanks, Schmitty. Talk to you soon.
And we're back.
Fellas, you think we could listen to the radio?
On Hail Varsity Radio, presented by the Nebraska Lottery.
Yes! That's awesome!
Back with you, Hail Varsity, presented by the Nebraska Lottery, on the road to Norman. Here we leave after the show, and we'll be broadcasting live from Norman, 105 East Boyd, the Cohiba Lounge. We are not taking the Labradoodle or the German Shepherd with, as they are full throat. It's like it's a third and two or something with a minute left, and the defense needs a stop. Let's bring in managing editor with HailVarsity.com and magazine, and author, Dream Like a Champion, with John Cook, Brandon Vogel, with us. Vogues, I know this gets your juices flowing, man. Nebraska, Oklahoma, you're headed down. That means it's a big game with Vogues in the press box, man. This is going to be good. Have you talked yourself into Nebraska keeping this thing close, or are you just all about the nostalgia here for Saturday morning?
I think Nebraska's got a shot. You know, you got to come out and you got to play well, which seems to be, well, it's an obvious thing to say. It's been a harder thing to do in practice for Nebraska to do that consistently enough. But, you know, Oklahoma's a really interesting kind of program when you take the long view. They, you know, it's a little bit different than Ohio State in that. They come out, they have this offense, they beat everybody, they win the Big 12 year after year. But then you've got these strange ones, you know. The Tulane game was almost that in week one this year. And you've had losses to Iowa State and Kansas State. So I think Scott Bross really put it well and really described kind of my approach to this game. It's like, there's a lot to gain. There's not a lot to lose. So come out and take your swings, essentially. It's been a while since we've seen Nebraska truly do that. So can they do that? And if they do early, I think they've got a shot to hang around at least.
Vogues, it'll be interesting to see a Nebraska team just go play free, right? When's the last time that's happened?
Really great question. I'm not sure we ever got there in 2018. 2017 is probably out. So you're looking at 5 years. Just off the top of my head, I can't think of a game where I was like, oh, I thought they really played free in that game. You might be back to 2016. And really, it'll seem a little strange. Like last week ended up feeling that way a little bit. I felt Nebraska played pretty free in a game where it was the flip side of what the Huskers are looking at here. You know, you beat Buffalo. There's not a ton of upside there, but there was a lot of downside, and Nebraska controlled that one. So, but it's been a while since I've truly felt Nebraska came out and said, hey, here we are. Let's go show we belong.
Brandon Vogel's with us from Hail Varsity. We're talking Nebraska, Oklahoma, ready to head to Norman and get this thing going. So, Vogues, with Adrian here in Rattler, you have contrasting styles, and it's not that Spencer can't do things with his legs. He's able to extend and can pick up a scramble here and there, but Adrian's been as good a dual threat weapon in college football this year, throwing the football, running the football. And he has looked great, and he has looked great, and he's not had all of his toys, right? The running game's been very miss, not as much hit. You've had some inconsistency with the offensive line. You've had injuries at wide receiver, with the exception of Toure. What can this offense do? Let's just pretend for a second it's full strength with the skill guys. I know it's meat and potatoes O-line. I know it's the run game that's huge. But what happens if you get a Betts back that's healthy? What happens if Oliver Martin is good to go? What happens if Allen and Omar can give you some reps here? What does that do to a Sooner defense that is way better with Grinch, but still can get disinterested if you look at the Tulane game?
Yeah, I mean, obviously having all of their receivers would be an asset. I still think looking at this game, you know, it, and some of this is based on what we've seen from the Huskers run game and the fact that it hasn't looked all that well oiled at this point. I think Nebraska has to kind of come out prepared to throw the football and use that as a weapon. And because through three games right now, they're averaging a gain of 15 plus yards on a pass on over 23% of their downs, which is a sea change from last year. That was like the big thing that was missing in 2020. Now they're getting that, not getting so much of the run game, but if you can hit some of those explosive plays, you're going to have to against an offense like Oklahoma just to keep pace, but those can be game changers too. So I think it's kind of a swing from your heels type of game. Now, part of the key to that would be making sure Adrian Martinez has enough time to be in the pocket. I mean, he's pretty good when you ask him to improvise, but that can also be where things get a little wily and out of control at times. So can he have enough time to sit back there and hopefully choose from the full complement of wide receivers Nebraska hoped to have opened the season with?
Brandon Vogel's with us here on Hail Varsity Radio. And Brandon, aside from being able to open up that passing game against Oklahoma, do you think that Nebraska is going to go with that design quarterback run a little bit more this game? We saw a little bit against Illinois, and it seems like they've pulled it back because they didn't really need it against Fordham and against Buffalo. The running game, while not being perfect, was a little bit better. Do you think we're going to see more design quarterback run to get that run game going against Oklahoma?
Yeah, that's a good call. And I think, you know, whether by design or which I think it probably was, but I don't know for sure, or whether just from how those games kind of unfolded, I think dialing back those number of quarterback carries and designed runs for Adrian Martinez was a good idea for Fordham and Buffalo weeks. But now, you know, you're going to need that. You're going to need your best player to have the ball in those such types of situations. So you dial it back up a little bit. And I think, you know, it could look a lot like Ohio State in 2018. I don't remember Adrian's number of carries in that game, but they were, you know, as a true freshman then, they were ready to really lean on him. And if he plays really, really well, you can do that and be in this game a lot longer than people expect. So I do think you'll see a pretty heavy usage rate for Adrian Martinez.
I think you have to. And I'm wondering here, Vogues, too, if you're Nebraska, if you sprinkle in some smothers option, or do you expect Nebraska to try and go at the edges, at the corners, versus trying to live and die between the tackles? Because Nebraska has not gotten a lot of push up the middle. Do they try going after the edge with option game, with some zone read quarterback keep? Adrian's not kept much when you're just doing the straight-up shotgun handoff. So there's a lot of different things, some new wrinkles we could probably see, or even just some more freedom with Adrian being able to carry it as many as 20 times as if he needs to.
Yeah, we've seen enough of the option, the option plays that they've run these past 2 weeks to make me think that, well, if that's one of the, you know, run looks that you can really execute well right now, you could be in store for more of it. Because, I mean, the option just by design is, hey, if you can get the guys blocked up front that you need to get blocked, it's meant to be a numbers advantage. And if you feel good about the guy making the decision to pitch or not to pitch, and in my opinion, Martinez has looked really good on that piece of it, and you like the guy carrying the ball, which so far has been Samori Toure, why wouldn't you see a little bit more of that? And you got to run between the tackles a little bit. You got to show you're at least willing to do it early on in the game, or at least willing to try it. But I think there's probably some things that are up Nebraska's sleeve that'll fold in and kind of snap in and snap off of these plays that we saw quite a bit of in the past 2 weeks.
Vogues, we'll get to volleyball in 2 seconds. A thought, if you're Scott Frost, is this just let's go, let's do this shootout thing? Or is this a Billy C. special where you're going to hold the football? Road trip to USC in 06, right? Make it 05, forgive me. Don't get those confused. But you hold on to this thing and just milk the clock. What's your approach if you're Frost?
Well, I think the approach should be, as crazy as it sounds, you go for the shootout and you go in there and say, like, all right, we're going to take our best shot. I mean, Lincoln Riley's lost 5 games as head coach at Oklahoma. All of those teams scored at least 37 points. They averaged to that group 40 points. Like, it's just what you got to do. Oklahoma's going to put up points. And Nebraska hasn't shown the consistency in the run game to just churn out yards and go on those kind of 9, 10, 11 play drives that almost allowed Army to shock Oklahoma in Norman a couple of years ago. So I don't know that that's much of a viable path. It'd be interesting if it were, but being that it isn't, Nebraska is going to probably have to outshoot Oklahoma. It's got just enough, I think, of kind of an explosive pass or explosive play potential to think, okay, maybe that can happen, but it's going to be tough, but I think it's the way to do it.
Vogue's got about a minute and a half here. Your reaction to Husker volleyball? They're a work in progress. They're still a piece of art. I mean, they're still really good, but they've really kind of got punched in the face a couple of times post-Creighton. What's your reasoning? About a minute.
Yeah, they're leaning heavily on freshmen, and, you know, they went real heavy to kind of see what they could do with 4 in the starting lineup. And that by nature is going to be a little up and down, particularly since we're still early in the season. But you can't pair that with kind of inconsistent performance from your veterans, I don't think. And that's what Nebraska didn't experience against Creighton. It's what it has experienced in the 2 losses since then. So that's kind of the big kind of long-term concern. And I think Nebraska volleyball is fine. But you need a little bit better play out of the players that you really counted on it coming from entering the year.
Brandon Vogel with us, managing editor, HailVarsity.com and magazine, at Brandon L. Vogel on Twitter. Get his book with John Cook, Dream Like a Champion. Vogues, are we going to get a steak and a potato after the game Saturday?
We'll see. Steaks are for winners, so it's not up to us.
Wow. You covered that well versus just saying, no, Schmidt, I'm not hanging out with you. You went with the, nah, steaks are for winners. I love it. That's pretty good. Vogue, safe trip. We'll see you down there, bud.
All right, take care. Bye.
There he is, Brandon Vogel with us at Hail Varsity. Gary Barnett's on the way. Dean Blevins next hour. Open phones here till 5-466-3776.
And now, back to Hail Varsity Radio.
Back into it. It's Hail Varsity Radio presented by the Nebraska Lottery. We need to spend a second on Brandon Vogel. And the how did you read that, Elijah? No, I don't want to hang out with you in Oklahoma, Schmidt. Or no, it's like ice cream. And I've had this rule for Junior, and he had a coach a few years ago that would, oh, kids, let's go get ice cream. No, they got their ass handed to them 17-4. They don't get ice cream for losing a baseball game that way.
Well, he never said
and,
that.
And you sure as hell don't get sprinkles.
He never said that he wouldn't go get a different dinner option with you. It was just specifically the steak. Maybe he'll go for like tacos or something. Like there's
well, but that, but his response is, yeah, hold on, steak is for winners. He's right.
Well, that's why we do the steak in a beer bet every single week on Friday.
That's because
steak is for winners. And right now you're more of a winner than me. I hate to say it, but
I hope. Right? But no, I mean, that was so good. I just couldn't tell the tone, the inflection. It's maybe because we're in Casa de Schmitz here before we pack the RV that maybe I'm just taking things a bit too personally. But Vogues can't avoid me in the press box, but he can sure as heck find a way out of post game. So good for him. So full coverage this weekend, Friday, Cohiba Lounge and Cigar Bar 4-6. The weekend edition, Saturday morning, Real Red Reaction from Cohiba, just two blocks from the stadium. So if you're a Nebraska fan, you want a smoky treat, I'm not telling you to use tobacco, but get a drink, enjoy. Awesome to have Joe Washington and his crew have us out. So more on Nebraska football here and just what needs to go down. And here's what's a question. Do you think Oklahoma is truly going to be different than Tulane? Wagner's Wagner. I guess I'm asking, how much is Oklahoma like Nebraska in the sense they can be sloppy, they can be disinterested, they can be focused? It's different, right? Nebraska tends to squeeze too hard because they're trying to get out of this funk. And Oklahoma has been reading the last 15 off seasons how many championships they're going to win. They're confident. Their head is swollen. They can't fit in the helmet anymore. Now they've been brought back down to earth thanks to Tulane. But Tulane can do a lot of things. Now what's kind of sickening but funny is Tulane did really well with swing passes, Elijah. as part of their 23-point mountain they had to climb back up, and they had a chance to go win it. I don't know what'll happen on Saturday, not knowing who's out and who's healthy. Now, Toure's key, but I think if you get Austin Allen back and you get a Martin back, I think that can help. Sorry, I'm not betting any money on Omar Manning. Heard too much about what he can be, and we've seen too little of him, right, to count on him. If I can get some Gabe Irvin in the open field with some option elements to it, right, I think that can work. And the one thing Nebraska has not done a ton of, other than Adrian on scrambles, is try and attack the outside. You haven't gone after that defensive end or outside linebacker or corner. Everybody made a living on it during the Riley era going after Nebraska corners. Why the hell try and run up the middle? It's going to run on the outside. Nebraska really isn't weak there. They set the edge well on the edge with the defensive end. They set the edge well with the corners. They do a wonderful job. So, you know, Nebraska's changed, thankfully, defensively with what their liabilities are. And you're going to see Oklahoma take some shots, make some shots, and Nebraska will give up some big plays. That's okay. How do you respond to a big play? Let's go to the phones real quick. Russ with us here on Hail Varsity Radio. Russ, thanks for calling, bud. Go ahead.
Hey, I just got a question. I just can't believe that we are in year four of the Scott Frost tenure, and we're talking about whether we can even compete with the big boys or not. I think that's something that needs to be discussed. You know, we thought by year four that we would be at least be able to hang with the big boys. And now we're talking about whether a Nebraska team can even compete with Oklahoma. That really alarms me. I mean, I'm a great fan, and I don't see much of a, you know, much hope in us going down there and winning Saturday. I'm hoping to not be embarrassed and play well and get ready for Michigan State. But I don't know why we're not talking about that. And I'm trying to be positive as much as possible, but the more we
discuss Russ, you sound beaten down and sad, my friend, and that's okay.
No, I think I'm realistic, and I don't think there's enough people talking about, you know, this is year four, and we're talking about whether we can even compete with a Big 12 team, and we're supposed to be Nebraska. So I guess what I'm doing is setting myself up so, you know, come 2:30 Saturday, I'm like, okay, well, we got Michigan State next week.
Russ, there's a couple of things. One, if Nebraska was in a better spot than they currently are, it may not matter. Oklahoma may be that good, okay? So it would be one of those situations. Can Nebraska go down and hang with a team that's a national title favorite? Thanks for your call. Thanks for listening. But, no, that's fair. You know, why are we not talking about year four and, you know, you should be further along? That's obvious, man. That's a reality. And Illinois was a gut punch, and now Oklahoma is kind of a measuring stick. And, yeah, should you compete with Oklahoma in year four? You would hope. And they have a chance to do that on Saturday. It's not likely. But they can do everything in their power to go play good football and let it go. See where it ends up.
I think this is about being able to change the narrative on your year four. Is it disappointing where Nebraska is at considering this is year four? Yes, obviously. Like, you don't want to lose to Illinois week one. You don't want to be let Fordham hang around for a quarter. You want to let Buffalo hang around for the first half whenever you're in Nebraska. However, they did enough to get the wins, and now you have a chance against a good Oklahoma to go change the narrative and not get embarrassed. Even if Nebraska loses this game, if they go lose by a touchdown, I think Nebraska fans leave that game with hope. So I think in the week leading up to a game, not knowing what's going to happen, this is about an opportunity to change a narrative, not about Nebraska is so bad, we're not far enough along for year four. It's about this is your chance. This is your litmus test to be able to say, can we compete with a team like Oklahoma?
You know, that's a good take, man. It's about the opportunity, the ability, and what lies ahead. How do you compete against a team that's a CFP favorite versus what's not gotten done? Now, they go compete. Maybe there's some fruition to the air quote process that's been ongoing, right? The recruiting, the development, the playmakers you've gone after, and maybe you can get a payoff on all of that. But yeah, it's been too messy. It's been too sloppy. Russ is not wrong with, dude, what's going on? This is year four. This is supposed to be, well, it's not. So your option is to be ticked that it's year four and you're not where Oklahoma's at, or look at the opportunity with Oklahoma on the docket. More calls here before 5 at Hail Varsity, presented by the Nebraska Lottery.
Chime in 402
866-ESPN or email the show, chris@hailvarsity.com.
Just try me. Try me.
Back to Hail Varsity Radio.
Some emails to get to and some tweets on Russ's call. So Kent chimes in here. First and foremost, he says Russ is spot on. And Ken asks the question, how many failed litmus tests do you need before you say, yep, this ain't working? And listen, that isn't for me to answer. And this isn't dodging the question. It's really up to Trev Alberts. And is the Oklahoma game going to make or break your decision on your head football coach? Where does it weigh? What's it in collaboration with Illinois? What are your expectations? And Trev has said, look, incremental improvement. You got to look like you're playing good football, and you can still. Trev's also said you can have a really, really good year in the Big Ten and go 7-5 because of how difficult it is. So I don't have an answer. I don't think this is a. If Nebraska goes and gets just drilled, well, okay, so be it. I mean, that's what the world thinks is going to happen. That's what Vegas thinks is going to happen. But you, as a Nebraska fan, you know, where are you at with that? And when it comes to the bigger discussion point that I'm not going towards, because I don't think Scott Frost is in trouble this year, and I don't know that he's in trouble next year. I know his record is not what it needs to be, but I just don't think Trev's going to come in year one and say, oh, damn it, you didn't go compete with Oklahoma. You're on thin ice. I don't see that. I think Trev gets how difficult and talented Oklahoma is. And, you know, what's Trev's viewpoint here? Is it from day one Trev's hired, or is it going back to Trev's been up in Omaha since Scott was hired here in 18? I mean, what's the prism you're viewing this for? To set your expectations for your head coach. You can go play way better football than you have against Illinois. You've done that the last 2 weeks. What kind of jump are you ready to make with your staff and your program here, Elijah, in a fourth year? That's fair. There's a body of work that is sub 500. But there's also an individual season and, yes, an individual game to look at here when you put it in context.
Yeah, and I mean, I forget the emailer's name saying how many failed litmus tests do you get.
Kent is emailing.
But I think there's levels to the litmus test. I know that's not how, like, the scientific, like, litmus test works. But there's levels to a football team in terms of where you're at against a team that you should be beating year in, year out in Illinois. That's one litmus test, but it's a completely different litmus test. Say, where are we at compared to a college football playoff contender? We saw it last year against Ohio State. We saw Nebraska come out for a quarter, and I don't want to say give Ohio State a scare, but they came out and competed for a quarter, and that's where we knew Nebraska was at last season in terms of where they're at in terms of the college football playoff and in terms of the top teams in the country. We get another look at it again this week against Oklahoma.
Yeah, it is a measuring stick game, and in year one, you saw Scott's team almost upset the probably the number five team that got left out of the college football playoff in Ohio State. So you've seen different results. It's not been consistent, right? That's the one thing that's been lacking is the consistency. What will you see more of a consistent run game? Will you see a better offense? Will you see a defense get some takeaways? All those things got to happen Saturday for Nebraska to hang around. And you're going to have an Oklahoma team that's not completely on their A game. They've just recruited better talent. You can outdo that. You can outcoach that.
They develop better, though, too.
They do develop well. Gary Barnett's on the way. Also, Dean Blevins next hour with Hail Varsity.
Welcome to Hail Varsity Radio, the voice of Husker Nation. Insight, opinion, expertise, with the biggest and best names talking Nebraska across the state. Join the show on Twitter at Hail Varsity and at Schmidt_radio. Call in at 402-466-ESPN or 1-800-825-5865. Here's Chris Schmidt.
Back in, it's Hail Varsity Radio, presented by the Nebraska Lottery. It's Nebraska-Oklahoma weekend, a huge weekend, a slate of college football. And we say hi to the Hall of Fame coach, Gary Barnett, Colorado and Northwestern. Coach, T-minus 30 minutes from jumping in the old RV. Have you been RVing before?
No, I haven't, Chris. And actually, I have no interest in RVing. So I hope you have a great time.
Well, that's a ringing endorsement. what are your reservations about RVing?
I don't have reservations. I just don't have any interest.
Okay.
You know, that's I think everybody is in one should have a lot of fun. And if I wanted to have that kind of fun, I'd get an RV. But I got other things going on. I don't know. You know, what can I tell you? I don't do it.
We've been talking Nebraska, Oklahoma all week. You're a guy who played and were on some really good Missouri teams that also competed in the Big Eight. From your perspective, what's your takeaway on the Nebraska and Oklahoma history and aura, I guess, surrounding that matchup, those two programs?
Well, you know, it's funny. When we were playing, Nebraska and Oklahoma were just two of the teams we played. We didn't see them as juggernauts. We didn't see them as colossals of college football, which they became, you know, after we were gone. And, you know, in the 70s, when Colorado and Oklahoma and Nebraska finished 1-2-3, I should say 3-2-1, mm-hmm. Then they started to be the bullies of the Big Eight. You know, those were the two teams. Colorado would peek its head in there every once in a while. Missouri never quite got in there. Nobody else really stood out. So they, you know, their lore and history and all that just sort of grew. When I was coaching, it was pretty much the same way. They just were really fun, important games, but I didn't see them as that much better than everybody else. And, I don't think a coach coaching somewhere else should see it that way either. But I didn't see it that way. But I always loved watching that game. But I also loved coaching in the Nebraska-Colorado game. And for a while, that game became bigger than the Oklahoma game. I mean, Oklahoma-Nebraska. Mm-hmm. You know, there was a time in which the Colorado-Nebraska game was bigger, but not for long. Always a great respect for both programs, great admiration. You know, it was always a fight. No matter what, loved being a part of it.
As you recruited, what was it like recruiting against Nebraska and against Oklahoma? From a quarterback standpoint, all three of you guys were going after the same dude.
Exactly. When we were recruiting Hagan and Anessi, it came down to Tom Osborne and Bill McCartney and me and whoever's recruiting them, George Darlington, mm-hmm. Who was recruiting the other guys. So, yeah, that was, and Oklahoma was in there, but Oklahoma pretty much stayed in Texas and for their quarterbacks. But we were in California, and of course, the great kid at Holloway was from Darian Hagan's high school. So, I guess they were in California as well. But yeah, it was always a battle for those guys. And then when things started to change, Mac went away from that kind of quarterback, then I think it changed a little bit. But, it was always a battle, you know, constantly. And, you just wanted your share of guys, and then you wanted to go play. Mm-hmm. So,
what's your thought on Lincoln Riley? Not only the job he's done, but also following Stoops like he has. And you know, Bob really rejuvenated Oklahoma football and made him great again. And now Lincoln's come in and been to a playoff. They've been knocking on the door. What kind of wows you about him and his work at OU?
Well, I think just the fact that he can step in for Stoops and take over without being there that long. It wasn't like he grew up in the history of that program. And so I think for him to come from where East Carolina, mm-hmm. and move in, take over, become the coordinator, and you know, and then Bob stepped down, and I think Bob stepped down a little earlier than everybody thought he would, and I think he did that because he had a successor. He knew that was the guy. And so for him to come in and not hardly miss a beat and keep it rolling at that high level. Now, part of it is Oklahoma is always going to roll at a pretty high level, but there was a period of time in there where the people that were ahead of that program or leading that program weren't as successful as Stoops and Lincoln Riley have been. So No, I give him a lot of credit. First of all, I think he really is a good coach, a really good coach. And I think he has the right things in his heart. And I think he does the right things by young people. And I think he's a good football coach. So, and to keep that going, you know, I think that's a great tribute to him. And that puts him up in the ranks, I believe, of college football, upper echelon.
Gary Barnett, few minutes talking Nebraska, Oklahoma, Hail Varsity Radio. Coach, your look at Nebraska here, we've seen the Big Red for three games. Illinois was Illinois, but a nice win against Buffalo. And Adrian had just an incredible game. You know, what are your thoughts on Nebraska? If you're putting a game plan together or you're putting some keys together here, let's stay competitive. How are you trying to accomplish that? What are some things you want to do and you think you can do based on what you've seen from Nebraska against OU on Saturday?
Well, I think you made a comment. They had a nice game against Buffalo. They need to have a nice game against yeah. Oklahoma, or a nice game against Minnesota, or a nice game. You know, that just needs the transition. You know, that play – playing at their level they played last week needs to transition to play against better competition. And more important, that step has to be taken. And you just can't have nice games against Buffalo and Fordham. You got to have nice games against everybody else, game in and game out. And that's what you're trying to get done, and that's the step that has to be taken. You know, I think this game, first of all, I think 22 points is too much. I don't think they're giving Nebraska's offense enough credit. Now, if they turn it over, then they are giving them enough credit. But if they don't, then I think this is not a 22-point spread. I do think Oklahoma will win the game, part of it being at home. Part of it is they probably overall are a little better. But statistically, Spencer Rattler's numbers aren't as good as Adrian Martinez's. The biggest issue I have with Nebraska is your leading rusher, your quarterback, is not only your leading passer, but he's also your leading rusher. That is an issue, because one day when that isn't possible and he's you know, you remove him from the game, what do you have? You don't have a passer or a rusher. And that's the biggest problem. That's the issue. That's the thin ice you're always on in the Nebraska offense right now. Where, you know, in Oklahoma's case, Rattler doesn't run the ball until he has to. He is an efficient, good thrower, couple picks already. His numbers aren't as good as Adrian's numbers, but, you know, he's highly touted. He has a lot of good people, a lot of good receivers around him, probably more so than Nebraska. Defensively, I think they're a suspect, as Nebraska has been. So that part of it, I think, is a decent matchup. And both offenses, it's going to have to be an offensive performance, I think, by the winning team. And I mean a really good offensive performance, because you're going to have to out-offense the other team, is what I've seen. And I've seen the stats. I watched a little bit of the Buffalo game. They went out ahead quick and looked good and sort of took control of the game. But if you look at the end statistics, first downs were about the same. Mm-hmm. Passing yardage was, you know, they had a lot, you know, as did Nebraska. So that nice game's got to transition over to a team like Oklahoma.
That's just it. And you touched on the rushing. What do you see with Nebraska's offensive line and running back rotation? I mean, as you view it, why do you think it's been such a hard sled for this Nebraska ground attack?
I just think probably, one, you got to be really committed to it.
Sure.
I mean, really committed to it. And when you got Adrian, you always have an out. And so you don't have to keep pounding it. You don't have to keep trying to find a way to run the football. You know, that's a lot of hard work. You've got a guy that can get you out of all that trouble. He can, you know, in the option, he can make up for whatever 2-yard gains you had with the running back, and now you've got a 9-yard gain. It's sort of like, I know he used to be asked all the time, why don't you run the fullback down on the goal line? I said, well, you know what? He averages 2 yards a carry. I've got a back that averages 7 yards a carry. Why would I give it to the guy that averages 2 yards a carry? So a little bit of that, You know, I think that you get caught up in that mentality. You don't have time necessarily or the resources to totally dedicate yourself to one. So you got to sort of play with what you got. And what they've got is a guy that can get you out of trouble. And that's why you're not forced. Now, if you lose Martinez, if he can't play, then you know what? I don't know how good you are at the backup spot as far as throwing the football, but you're going to have a running game. And then all of a sudden, you're going to have to really develop that other part of it. I mean, that's you sort of get to that bridge when it falls down, but it hasn't fallen down yet.
Well, I'm just the experience level of the offensive line. Guys have started, they've played. It just doesn't seem like they're getting much movement or they're holding their blocks. But I think you nailed it. I think what you said here about how, you know, are you really committed to it? If Scott had his choice, he'd probably chuck it around as much as he did at Central Florida, right? I know they still technically ran it a lot, but he likes doing that style, a high-flying offense. And two, you're right, Adrian is kind of the ultimate equalizer here to get you out of some tough run spots. Can that be extended for this season? Coach, a last thought before we get to some rapid fire and some ball games this weekend. You know, what would a win do for Scott? I mean, say you pull this off and you just don't stay competitive, but you actually go get the upset.
Well, if you go get the upset, then what you're going to have is, you know, expectations for play in the Big Ten is going to be doubled and tripled. And so, you know, every success buys you an admission ticket to a more difficult problem. And so that's what it would do. It's going to get him an admission ticket to a more difficult problem. That is, you know, finishing higher in the Big Ten than you know, maybe possible. I don't know, but that's what's going to happen.
Well, a thought here. Yeah, the Buffs and the Gophers. Minnesota doesn't have Ibrahim, and he was a fun back to watch. But, man, the Buffs were right there against A&M. Now you got Minnesota coming in.
We were right there. And, Chris, I got to tell you, it was a great game to call. It was one of those games where every play mattered. Every single play in that game mattered. And first downs were like gold, you know. And that's why, because nobody could get them, that's why every play seemed to matter. And it was just amazing the work done by both defenses in that game. And it came down to the last 3 minutes, and they created a matchup, which is what good coaches do. And what the game gets down to is they got a matchup, knew it, and threw the ball right to the kid. They matched up their back on a wheel route with a linebacker that was on the line of scrimmage. And he peaked. He had him man. You know, it was actually a Nebraska transfer guy, Thomas Guy. And so he peaked. He peeked for a minute into the backfield, and he got beat on the outside, and that was the whole ball game. It all came down to one play, really. And so, you know, but it was a heck of a game. And so they are close. And this week, this game is going to be close. The two very similar teams, one, you know, they're a big physical offense, and we're a pretty big physical defense. So, you know, I think it's a really fun matchup. It may be exactly the same kind of game we had last week.
What do you think about Bama and Florida?
You know, on another show, I picked Bama with the spread. I'm rethinking that a little bit, but I, you know, Bama still wins the game. I'm not sure about for 15 points, but playing against two different quarterbacks, you know, that'll be interesting to see whether it bothers the defense more or bothers the offense more.
Miami, Michigan State.
Yeah, I'm not buying Miami, and I'm not buying Michigan State yet, but one of those, Miami is, you know, can't seem to get any traction, and Michigan State seems to have it. So, you know, I think that's a really tough game to call. I find it hard for me to root for Mel Tucker, and if I picked him, I'd have to root for Mel Tucker. So I'm going to give you a no answer there.
That's fine. That's fine. Last thought here, Coach. Eric Bieniemy and USC, what do you believe?
Well, you know, funny, I haven't talked to Eric, but I was on a Kansas City radio station, and they brought that up. And I think Eric's so close to getting an NFL gig that if he were to call me, I'd say sit tight. Mm-hmm. Because you got to really want to do the college stuff. You got to, you know, you got to figure out you're not going to do any football for a while. You're going to do all sorts of other stuff. And if you want to be a play caller, it's hard to be a play caller and a head coach at USC. And so you got so many other things you have to do. And, you know, you've got so much of a simpler gig in the NFL. I'm not saying harder or easier. I just say simpler. Mm-hmm. And it's much more complicated at college. And do you want to get yourself into that, is what I'd say.
Gary Barnett. Coach, we'll get caught up again. Thanks for the time today.
You bet. Good being with you, Chris. Have fun.
And now, back to Hail Varsity Radio.
Back into it at Hail Varsity Radio, presented by the Nebraska Lottery, getting ready for Nebraska, Oklahoma. And we bring in a Sooner great. And, of course, with the sports animal and News 9 in Oklahoma City, Dean Blevins, your author of Sooner Magic back in 76. Dean, it's good to spend time with you. Thanks for the time.
Well, it's been fun. It's always fun to be with you, Chris. We've been doing this for decades. But, yeah, you mentioned that Sooner Magic in that game. That was back in 1976. It's been fun here in Oklahoma to finally relive some of that because there have been so many programs and things in the paper and websites that have been like your top three, your top five, top ten memories of Oklahoma-Nebraska games, and that year has come up frequently, which I presume it probably wouldn't up in Lincoln.
No, I think the fondness is focused on 71, a little bit north of where you're at. I think you look at 83 with Neil Harris.
Absolutely.
And then the first game my father took me to that was Nebraska-Oklahoma. That we, you know, my brother and I kind of earned the, you guys are old enough to go type little nod.
Yeah.
was one with Calvin Jones. So.
There have been so many great, 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 great players because the schools have had so many All-Americans and honorees and national champions. It's just ridiculous when you start going down through the list. It's ridiculous that we don't play every year, for one thing. But it is ridiculous the amount of talent that was thrown out there when Devaney rolled through here with his team, and I guess it was the game was in Lincoln in 70, but win a championship, mm-hmm. and then up here for that 71 and do it again, and then just the number of stars. It's just been amazing to I hope that some of the Nebraska people have had a chance to look back at some of the games because it's been fascinating.
It has, and you're right about doing it every year. That'd be a lot of fun. I don't know that it'd be real fair. that's the concern by Nebraska.
Yeah, it's not even an elephant in the room. It's not even an elephant in the room. It's just there. Scott Frost mm-hmm. got to get his guys really playing and really winning and continuing to recruit better and better. And, you know, I don't expect Nebraska to win. I do expect it to be more competitive than most. But this is a game that would, if he could help pull this thing off, no better game to help, set you on the right path.
Dean Blevins with us, Hail Varsity Radio, at Dean Blevins on Twitter, News 9 in Oklahoma City. And, of course, he hosts the Lincoln Riley Show. And what's the mood been like around Oklahoma City and Norman, Dean, with this matchup here? You've talked about the nostalgia. We've talked about the nostalgia. But when it comes to just this Oklahoma team, you know, are they living up to expectations or is there some concern with this group of Sooners?
Well, the expectation level has been so ridiculously high. It tends to be that, I guess, in all places, Chris. But at Oklahoma it does because people just want to win another national championship so badly. And, you know, they finished with a good team last year, finished with winning 8 or 9 in a row. And they also got a shorthanded Florida team and just rolled them in the bowl game, and so there was more momentum from that. The Sooners did lose six players who are playing a lot on NFL Sundays from last year's team. So the perception around a lot of places, including here, was that Oklahoma didn't lose anything, where the truth is they lost six really, really good players. One of them happened to be the heartbeat and an emotional leader and the big playmaker, Perkins on defense, number seven, and he's now with Bill Belichick and those guys. But he's an emotional leader, and the reason I'm bringing that up is that the one thing this team lacks is it doesn't have a Baker Mayfield, a leader that just demonstrates it from the beginning of the game all the way throughout. Spencer Rattler has never been that. I think he's trying to do a little bit more of it right now, but they're asking fullbacks to be a leader and new guys on defense to be a leader. And I do believe that is a factor, and was even in their first game this year when they should have just blown out Tulane and had them on the ropes and let them come back and almost beat them.
Dean Blevins with us. When it comes to mentality, the talent's there, but the killer instinct, Dean, is that something that's a work in progress, or is it just guys aren't used to being in position to demand a high level? They just want to go play ball versus demanding that you hit a certain standard or a certain level?
Well, I think it's two things. I think it's one, just not the natural born leaders around there that a team has to have. So they're trying to manufacture some of that. But it's also not finishing games. They did it again the other night against Tulane, where they jump up some 24 points, I think it was, like at halftime, and should just put them away, and had to hang on to win. And they have done that so many times, most of the time at home. Iowa State's come back for a win. Kansas State was just dead last year. Oklahoma had them down 21 points with just a few minutes to go, and they start getting on skates on defense and letting guys make plays and scores. And offensively, as genius as Lincoln Riley is, the one thing that he gets criticized around here for, and from me as well, is not having guys, when they do jump out the leads, not coming out and putting your foot on the throat. So that's an issue, and that is something that Nebraska could very well get behind early. Don't know that they will, but Oklahoma is a very fast-starting team, and so if they fall behind by 17 points, 14 points, don't give up. Just keep an eye on this.
Dean Blevins with us, Hail Varsity Radio, Sooner Insider, at Dean Blevins on Twitter, News 9 Oklahoma City, and host of the Lincoln Riley Show and Sooner Great. So, Dean, when you look at Nebraska, from what you've kind of gleaned and gathered with the Big Red, what are your impressions from afar? What do you think of Adrian from your position of quarterback, and what do you think of this Nebraska offense?
Well, I think of Martinez. I've watched him since he took a snap the first day, and I've seen every game this year. I try to watch every one of them every year, and mostly do. But this year particularly, I've seen these first few games, and really, really impressed with him. He just seems to be a better quarterback. It just seems to be totally seasoned, which he should be. But his mobility is even better than I thought it was. Oklahoma has been susceptible to dual threat quarterbacks, so I think you can keep an eye out on that and see if Martinez can keep Nebraska in the game or maybe take a lead, because I think that opportunity will be there. I think across the board, Oklahoma will have a defensive front advantage over Nebraska's offensive front, and that's become a strength of the Sooners. It was not very good for several years here, especially when LSU was scoring 100 and Alabama was beating Oklahoma. But this Grinch, Alex Grinch, is in his third year. He's done a fabulous job in acquiring talent and coaching them, and the best part of it, Chris, is that he's got down linemen and a bunch of them. If you extend it into the rush linebackers, they've got eight or nine guys that they keep fresh up there, and most of them can really play. So I think that that's going to be an area that Nebraska will have to work around.
Dean, on the flip side of things, the perspective of Oklahoma from Nebraska fans has been really very talented athletic offensive line, a quarterback in Spencer Rattler, who is a five-star and is very good, but a little bit unsettled in the run game. I think only two scholarship running backs for the Sooners. So I think the sentiment from Nebraska fans has been this Oklahoma offense will go as far as Spencer Rattler could take them. Would you say that that's a fair assessment?
Well, it probably is. Yeah, because he is just so special. And if he's not on his game like he wasn't the first game, he felt that they were just cakewalking and he didn't do the little things and he got sloppy with the football and didn't play winning football. Then he came back the next week against an even worse team and really, I mean, he was out at half with five touchdowns. But he's got to be on point, and I think Lincoln really jumped him after that first game. I think he's a much better player or is much more somewhat of a leader, but really he's on point more is probably the best way to describe it. I will say this, though. The two running backs that Oklahoma's had, they've had a bunch of people in and out the last few years due to transfer and injuries, but Oklahoma's been running back to you around here for a while. Kennedy Brooks missed last year, but he's already registered two 1,000-yard seasons at Oklahoma. So he is a grizzled veteran who's really good. And then they brought in this kid, Gray, from Tennessee. And he's a guy that is smaller, shiftier, and one of the better backs in the SEC. So I think they're pretty good there, even though, as you rightfully said, they don't have the depth. The receivers are better than people think. They've got a bunch of five stars out there, even though they've had five stars get hurt and leave. They still have a bunch of really good talent out there. It's the offensive line. And I don't know that Nebraska – you guys will have to tell me. Is Nebraska's defensive front good enough to do what I think OU's will to Nebraska? Is Nebraska's defensive front good enough to take advantage of what I consider to be a work in progress in Oklahoma's offensive line?
Dean, I think Nebraska's defensive line is a strength. When it comes to just getting pressure with four, though, I have not seen it. They've been better, okay, but they like to send an extra rusher. From time to time, Nelson and Caleb Tanner have been way better as they've gotten older. But I just don't know, based on kind of the pedigree and talent level Oklahoma has, if Nebraska will be able to get home or rattle, no pun intended, Spencer at all, and kind of flushing him out of his comfort zone. That's going to be so big for Nebraska to get after.
Yeah.
And disrupt, because I think Oklahoma is going to be able to do it to Adrian. Because a lot of the teams, Illinois and Buffalo, they've gotten after Nebraska with just four, and Adrian's gone magician to get out of some problems. Dean, last thought, and it's so wonderful to talk to you and look forward to seeing you in Norman. When it comes to the former players and the fans, we know what this rivalry means. What about the current group of Sooners that are kicking off Saturday? What do they think of Nebraska?
Well, Lincoln has done a good job of educating them. As we all know by just mathematics, these kids were 4, 5, 6, you know, when they were last playing against one another. But Nebraska is talked up in these parts so much, and particularly since they've been on the schedule for a while, that I think the kids, they now appreciate it. He's shown them a 71 game. Don't know if he showed the ending, but he showed them a 71 game and showed them a lot of the others. And they appreciate it. But how big a factor is that? It's not a big factor. And if anything, they will not be as amped up for this game as they should be. And if Nebraska comes in here really ready to play, I think that they, frankly, have a little bit of an advantage from that standpoint.
Dean Blevins, Sooner standout, of course, Sooner insider at Dean Blevins on Twitter, News 9 in Oklahoma City, and host of the Lincoln Riley Show. Dean, we're headed your way. Thanks so much for everything.
You bet, bud. I'll see you tomorrow and Saturday. Take care, guys.
He's in his 30s, but sounds like he was born with a stogie in one hand and a brew in the other.
Now, say my name.
It's Schmidt on Hail Varsity Radio.
I got the body of a taut preteen Swedish boy.
Back into it, it's Hail Varsity Radio Roadshow, soon to commence as we head down to Norman. We welcome in the pride of Chicago, Danny Burke, Burke's Best Bets, VEASAN Sports Network. Danny will be on the air 6 to 7 Monday through Friday with his show, Rush Hour. Daddy, Oklahoma, Nebraska, how you doing?
Well, Schmitty, you know, I'm excited in the sense that we get to see Oklahoma play, you know, a little bit more of a competitive team, you would hope. But obviously last week wasn't the easiest matchup for the Sooners. Now, that doesn't necessarily give me hope for the Huskers, but I'm at least excited for this maybe first quarter, first half. But once it gets into that second half territory, I think the floodgates could be opening. But aside from that, Schmitty, I am pretty excited for it.
You know, it's Oklahoma, it's Nebraska. We've been smiling all week. Yes, there is a game on Saturday, and it's a measuring stick for Nebraska. It's a chance to change some minds nationally and locally with a win. I don't know that that's going to happen, but you can sure as heck play good football, be competitive, and lose to a better team. What's your take on Oklahoma? Nebraska, the 22.5. Are you running from that, or are you saying, that's too high? Give me Nebraska. Where are you leaning right now?
So, honestly, my lean is fading the Huskers here, Schmitty. And certainly there's a scenario where they can keep it close and cover that number because it is really high. And, again, based on what we saw last week with Oklahoma, certainly there's a blueprint I heard you talking about a little bit. There is that blueprint that maybe Nebraska can keep it close. But you also have to consider, you know, Oklahoma's not just looking at this game and thinking the Huskers are a crap team or anything like that. They realize that this is a big program and still have some talent there and that they're going to be coming in acting like this is their Super Bowl. And, you know, this line, I think, opened like 21.5, and like you alluded to now, 22.5 in some spots. I'm personally not playing it, but if I had to, I honestly would lean toward Oklahoma. I think they probably win this game by about 24 or so. Again, I wouldn't be shocked if Nebraska keeps it close in the first half like we saw against Ohio State last season, and then the floodgates just go wide open in the second half because, you know, more familiarity and comfort with this Oklahoma team going into their third game as well. So I think that offense is going to be ready to go. It, of course, is going to come down to how good Nebraska's defense can at least contain Rattler and company, but can the offense get any momentum? Because this Oklahoma defense, you know, at least my thoughts and a lot of other people, was supposed to be really good coming into this year, and they've been solid. But, again, now this is kind of, you know, more so real competition for them this season. And if Nebraska avoids the three and out, if they can actually get some running attack going, and if Martinez can hit those key throws, whether it's the short and precise ones or the big plays, that could be the difference maker of keeping you in the game or not, then, yes, they can cover. That's a lot of ifs, Schmitty, and Nebraska hasn't been able to handle all those ifs in the past.
You know, it's been Nebraska hurting Nebraska this time. If Nebraska hurts Nebraska and Oklahoma hurts Nebraska, there will not be enough beer in Norman to console the folks wearing red and white. Danny Burke is with us, Burke's Best Bets. Danny's Dimes here, VSiN Sports Network, Rush Hour 6 to 7 Central across America. So you're fading the Huskers. That makes sense. There's some in-game stuff I think you'll do. What's the over-under currently right now with Nebraska and OU?
Currently, I don't have it pulled up in front of me. I'm driving right now, Schmitty, so I apologize. But look, whatever it's set at, honestly, I'd be leaning toward the over, if anything, in that spot, considering that, like I said, I mean, when you typically have a high spread, like we're seeing in this game, that tends to gravitate more toward the over, at least if you have somewhat of a competent offense on the other side, which Nebraska does. It's just a matter of if they can execute well enough to keep it close in this game. And if they can, if Nebraska can at least get you maybe, you know, in that 17-point range, then I think Oklahoma should be able to handle the rest and get this total to go over.
64 is the over-under. Danny, any other games of interest, either college or NFL? Are you biting on Cincinnati, Indiana? Do you like Sparty in Miami? Have you felt okay going with Roll Tide over Florida? That's still a hefty number on the road in the swamp.
A few games I actually circled out, Schmitty. I'm fading Northwestern this week on the road against Duke. I know Duke hasn't looked stout by any means, but neither has Northwestern, and I don't trust them in the road in this spot, laying three, so I took three with Duke. Also a little bit lesser of a game, but over 58.5 UTSA Middle Tennessee. But the one I also like a lot, how about Penn State and Auburn under 53.5? I think that's a little bit too high for both of these teams that have solid defenses. Bo Nix is going to have some competition finally to go up against. Last year didn't do great against it. Same with Clifford when he had a lot of turnovers. So I think this is going to be kind of a slow, methodical ground type of game where the defenses step up. And I like Penn State and Auburn to stay under 53 in the hook.
Are you going to jump on Fresno State in the plus 11? UCLA's been playing good ball. Fresno's been nasty.
Yeah, that one's a tough one, Schmidt. It really is, because you're right. I mean, UCLA is finally coming alive under Kelly. And, you know, Fresno has had their highlights themselves. I think that one is going to be kind of your perfect in-game betting scenario. You know, let's see what UCLA can do out of the gates against another good offense. Let's see if Fresno can keep up with them. And if it's close toward the end, then you can kind of see the momentum in the game, and I think you're going to be able to get a lot better line on whichever team, well, at least if you're favoring UCLA in this spot, because I do think they edge them out. But again, I think there's going to be a time in this game where Fresno's keeping it close, and you can jump on UCLA for a little bit better action than pre-flop.
Danny, NFL, any game you like? You have a lean Chiefs-Ravens at all?
Chiefs-Ravens, this line has gotten a little out of hand now that it's over the key number of 3. The total has bumped down a little bit as well, which I kind of don't hate too much. But until the Ravens kind of figure out their consistent offense with all their issues, I'm probably staying away. But believe it or not, Schmitty and Noe, this comes back to haunt me, right? I'm actually betting my Bears this weekend, taking them on the money line against the Bengals. I don't think you could overreact to what happened this past Sunday, because that's what was expected to happen, right? I mean, the Rams are the better team. They have a solid defense. And as good as their defense had been, you know, Montgomery was able to move the ball, and they're certainly going to be able to do that against the Bengals. And the Vikings got 5 sacks on Burrow, so hopefully that Bears interior that they've spent so much money on is able to destroy this Bengals offensive line. And at the end of the day, at the home opener, Schmitty, this Bears team is going to get the win. At least that's what my bankroll is banking on for Sunday.
Danny, not a betting question. Is it time to start Justin Fields?
Oh, it's been time to start Justin Fields since, what, they drafted him day one. But I understand why they're doing what they're doing, because they see the route of Patrick Mahomes, of Aaron Rodgers, and Nagy wants to have the same thing. He doesn't want to get labeled as a guy that rushed Justin Fields too quickly. So I think there could – my original thought was that because of how tough the schedule was, not that I would put money on it, but there is a real scenario where Fields could start after the bye week based on how tough that stretch is, week 6 through 9, and that Andy Dalton could do well enough beforehand. However, the other route – is that, you know, Justin Fields could get put in week 4 against the Lions. That's certainly a good spot for him to start out. But if Andy Dalton can't get any offense going against the Bengals, and I think we are going to see Justin Fields in as the starter more than one rep at a time. It was promising that you saw him get some action last game, but now that he's gotten a little taste of it, if there's no offensive momentum, then I think they'll actually put him in against the Bengals.
Danny Burke, Pride of Chicago. Danny, we'll catch up next week. Thanks for a few minutes, bud.
Absolutely, Schmitty. Root the Huskers in this weekend, my friend.
Miss us?
Come here, brother. Give me a hug. Bring it in for the real thing.
We're on call for you. Catch the podcast at HailVarsity.com, the ESPN Lincoln app, or download them on iTunes.
Saddle up, partner.
Back to Hail Varsity Radio.
Winding down here, Hail Varsity Radio is the road to Norman set to commence. I need to take a hot tub with me, win or lose, and the place to go for that, Deb the Spa Lady, Home Innovation Spas, 20th and Highway 2 in Lincoln, off Industrial Road in Omaha, spasonline.com. Deb, can you pick me out a hot tub for the road trip?
Hey, yeah, I think I could get one small enough to get in an RV. So I could, I mean, really, we have everything. 2-person up to the 19-foot swim spa. Maybe we just put some wheels and a motor on that 19-footer and take off.
We'll just pull it behind and just kind of
hang
out
there. Oh, there you go. There you go. I like it. That's being creative.
It is, and there's all sorts of choices. You mentioned that. And, Deb, when folks come see you at Home Innovation Spas, you do have a selection for everybody. And when I mean everybody, you have the baseball fan covered, the football fan covered, and even the hoops fan covered. And nothing like watching a ball game from the comfort of your own spa.
That's right. And a lot of people will set their spa up so that they can see into maybe another room or maybe inside so they can watch a ball game from outside. Or they'll put a little TV outside, mount it out there, and then watch ball games, because there's nothing better than being sitting in a hot tub while you're watching your favorite team play.
Well, and you're still smiling with your Chiefs win over the weekend. I know that. Big one coming up against Baltimore on Sunday. But, Deb, if folks want to come see you before kickoff or after kickoff or sometime in between, how do they do it?
Well, they could come to either one of our stores, Lincoln in at 20th and Highway 2, Omaha, 138th at Industrial. You can come to our website, spasonline.com, anytime, 24/7. If you've got questions, leave us an email, and we'll get them answered right away, and we'll find one for you. I mean, we actually have spas either in stock or at least on their way, so you're not going to wait a year to get a hot tub.
Don't wait a week. Go see Deb towards the end of this week or into the weekend. Home Innovation Spas, 20th and Highway 2 in Lincoln off Industrial Road in Omaha. Spasonline.com. Deb will wave at you from Norman, okay?
Okay, I'll be watching.
Winding down a Thursday edition of Hail Varsity Radio here presented by the Nebraska Lottery. What a show it was today. As if you missed the first hour, you can check that out on our live stream that's posted up, ESPNLincoln.com. You can also check out all the interviews as we had Joel Makovicka back in Hour 1, as well as Brandon Vogel, Gary Barnett kicking off Hour 2, OU Insider and former Sooner Dean Blevins was with us about 30 minutes ago. We also had the Pride of Chicago, Danny Burke, Burke's Best Bets, a completely loaded show here on a Thursday as we're getting you all geared up for Nebraska and Oklahoma getting kicked off Saturday at 11 o'clock down in Norman. That's where the Hail Varsity show will be for the next couple of shows, as Chris now on the road to Norman in the RV. So, tomorrow, show is at 105 East Boyd Street in Norman. It's three blocks from the stadium. That is the Cohiba Cigar Lounge down there for Joe Washington's cigar release event, as it's also going to be honoring the game of the century. That's where we're at, 4 to 6 tomorrow. Saturday morning edition at 7 to 9 here locally on ESPN Lincoln. And then, as always, the Real Red Reaction Show immediately following the game. That's what's coming up, as we're going to check in tomorrow from Norman. It's Hail Varsity Radio presented by the Nebraska Lottery.